Morning. Hope you all are following my classes. So before going to the diseases which causes balance disorders like Meniere's or benign paroxysmal positional vertigo, BPPV, etc., you should know how to evaluate a case of dizziness or a vertigo. In the coming to a diagnosis of vertigo, or to find out the cause of vertigo, the history taking and clinical examination is of paramount importance. Of this, the most important one is the history taking. You should give enough time for the patient to tell her problems and ask the patient to describe the problem, and you have to ask it in an open-ended question. That is, you give time for the patient to tell. Don't probe in between. As far as possible, don't probe and give some time. Be a listener, be a good listener, and give some time for the patient. Or you can give a questionnaire with all the important questions or important things you have to ask. That is also another good idea, so that you can save time. In the consultation room, in the waiting area, you can give the questionnaire for the patient. And if the patient tells that I am having giddiness or I am having a dizzy feeling, ask the patient to define what dizziness means to him. Okay. There are so many explanations for dizziness. So ask the patient, what do you feel? Endaanu thonunnathu? Adaanu chodikkendathu. Endu thonunnu? What do you feel? And ask him to describe his dizziness. After the history taking, the examiner should be able to answer the following questions from the patient's response. And what are the questions? Let us see. One thing, that is evaluation of vertigo. Evaluation of dizzy patient. So all these important questions should be answered. So the first one is, does the patient have vertigo? That's the first question that you should answer. You should be able to answer this. Patient have vertigo or not? That means if the patient is having a true vertigo. So what are the other other than true vertigo, it can be an oscillopsia, or it can be a disequilibrium, or it can be an unsteadiness, it can be a lightheadedness or a presyncope. So all these are described to an extent in my class on examination of ear. So if any doubt on terminologies like oscillopsia and true vertigo, just go back to my class on examination of ear and then come back. Okay. So one thing is, the patient is having a true vertigo or not. So oscillopsia, then disequilibrium, then unsteadiness, lightheadedness and presyncope should be ruled out. Okay. And if the patient is having a true vertigo, ask him whether he is having this symptom episodic or continuous. Okay. Episodic or continuous. Intermittent or continuous, that's all. Whether it is having all the time or it is coming and going intermittently. And also ask him the duration of each attack. Okay. Duration of each attack should be asked. And what are the, if any symptoms associated with this, associated symptoms you should ask. What are the associated symptoms? Asked in ear, in the ear what all things can happen? Associated, sometimes the patient will tell that I am having a pain in the ear or discharge in the ear along with the giddiness. So in the ear you have to ask for discharge or pain or a hearing loss, tinnitus or ear fullness. You can, in many diseases you can have a fullness of ear, tinnitus along with the sensory neural hearing loss. So in the ear, then in which area? Eye is important. In the eye, what all things can happen? There can be loss of vision or there can be a diplopia. Okay. Then also asked about headache. Okay, headache. In the central nervous system, if there are any associated paresthesia or paralysis of any part of the body, or in vertebral basilar insufficiency, you will get a dysarthria, or there will be a dysphagia associated with this. So, associated symptoms should be asked. Okay. Especially in the ear, eye and the central nervous system. And in panic attack, patient will have sweating, dyspnea and palpitation. Okay. If the patient is having, sometimes the giddiness may be due to a panic attack, and in that condition, the patient will be having an associated sweating, dyspnea and palpitations. The fourth one is, do the patient's symptom reflect the disorder from semicircular canal or from the otolith organ? How can you know that? Whether it is from the semicircular canal or from the otolith organ. How can you know that? If it is from the semicircular canal, the patient will be having nystagmus. So what will be the complaint? Patient will tell that there is moving. I feel like some problem with my eyes. Moving of eyes or the object, there is a sudden jerk of my vision. So if so, it will be due to semicircular canal. And if the patient is telling you that I am having an abnormal sensation of sudden drop attack or tilt, or there will be a sudden drop attacks. Then it is due to otolith organs. Okay, that also you will get. And whether there is any underlying medical problems that could cause or exacerbate the patient's symptom. Underlying medical problems. What are the underlying medical problems that can cause or exacerbate the patient's symptoms? What are they? It can be due to a thyroid disorder, or it can be a diabetes mellitus or anemia or an autoimmune disease. Then hypoperfusion of the brain. From which all conditions? Hypoperfusion of the brain resulting from postural hypotension or cardiac arrhythmia, or also ask for any medication history. So in ask for any thyroid disease, diabetes mellitus, anemia, autoimmune disorder, and any history of postural hypertension or cardiac arrhythmias, and also ask the patient whether he is taking any medicines. And underlying psychogenic disorder. Some psychogenic disorders, especially anxiety disorders, panic disorders, and agoraphobia. What is this agoraphobia? It is patient will have a panic attack or a sudden feeling of embarrassment on reaching some spaces, and that will cause a giddiness or a dizzy feeling. So ask for any associated psychogenic disorders, especially anxiety disorders or phobias and panic disorders. Another is, what brings this problem? Okay. എന്ത് ചെയ്യുമ്പോഴാണ് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഏതെങ്കിലും പൊസിഷനിലാണോ ഈ ഒരു തലകറക്കം വരുന്നത്? സോ ഈസ് ദർ എനി ഹെഡ് മൂവ്മെൻറ്റ്സ്? ഓക്കെ, വൺ ഹെഡ് മൂവ്മെൻറ്റ്, ചേഞ്ച് ഇൻ ഹെഡ് മൂവ്മെൻറ്റ്, ഹെഡ് പൊസിഷൻ, ഓർ എനി സ്പെസിഫിക് ബോഡി പൊസിഷൻ. ബോഡി പൊസിഷൻ ഓർ എനി സ്റ്റിമുലേ ലൈക്ക് സഡൻ സൗണ്ട്, ഹൈ എക്സ്പോഷർ ടു noise. Some patient will tell you that, especially the patients having a superior canal lesion syndrome will tell you that on exposing the to loud sound, I am having a vertigo, or I am having a giddiness on exposure to loud sound in a superior canal lesion syndrome. So all that area. So what brings the problem? You should know what brings this problem to the patient. Is it a head movement, or it is a specific body posture, or any other conditions like an exposure to loud noise, etc. And you should also ask for any preceding history of trauma, whether a patient is having a head injury or any surgery to the ear or to the head. That is also very important. And under the medication, specifically ask for hypertension, diabetes mellitus and anxiety disorders, or any psychiatric problems. So all these, the treating surgeon or the examiner should be able to answer all these questions. So even from a very good, after a very good history taking, we will be able to come to a provisional diagnosis. That is the importance of history taking in case of a giddiness or a vertigo, right? You should also know that there are some distinguishing features between a central vertigo and a peripheral vertigo. What is peripheral vertigo? It is due to disorders of the labyrinthine system. Example like Meniere's disease or a BPPV or a serous labyrinthitis, etc. Or it can be due to central causes. Central causes, example is syringomyelia or tumors of the pontomedullary junction or multiple sclerosis, etc. So there are some distinguishing features between these two, mainly nystagmus. Okay. So features, peripheral vertigo and central vertigo. The first one is nystagmus. Okay. So what is the character of nystagmus in peripheral vertigo and central vertigo? So regarding the type of nystagmus, we can write first the type of nystagmus. In a peripheral vertigo, it can be a combined type. It can be horizontal or it can be vertical. Especially in a horizontal semicircular canal, it is usually horizontal nystagmus. And in superior or the posterior semicircular canal, it is usually a vertical type. So, combined nystagmus. But the central variety is purely one type. Either it can be a vertical type, or it can be a horizontal type, or it can be a torsional type. There won't be any combinations of more than one type. So, that is very important. So type is important. Another one is direction. In peripheral, it is always in one direction. But in central, can change the direction. Okay, direction can be changed. And in visual fixation, the visual fixation may inhibit the nystagmus of peripheral disorder, but it won't. That's why we ask the patient to wear a Frenzel glasses while examining for nystagmus in case of peripheral vertigo. Okay, so visual fixation will inhibit that of peripheral variety, but there won't be any change in case of a central lesion. And this peripheral vertigo is, peripheral nystagmus is fatigable. It is fatigable, but it is not fatigable in case of central causes. And there is a latency in case of peripheral, but there is no latency in central. Okay, or latency present and absent. That is how we can. Present, absent. That is why I told that in the examination of ear, when you ask the patient to look at the tip of your fingers for examining the nystagmus, at least keep it for 30 seconds. Don't move it like this. That is because there is a period of latency in a case of peripheral nystagmus, but there is not so in case of a central nystagmus. So this is the differences between nystagmus in case of peripheral variety and central vertigo. And another difference is that imbalance. What about the imbalance? Imbalance. Most often, the imbalance will be associated with the central vertigo. And in peripheral vertigo, imbalance may or may not be there, but anyway, the patient will be able to walk. But in case of a central vertigo, the patient will not be able to stand or even to walk. Okay, to walk or even to stand. So, imbalance, patient will be able to walk. but here the patient won't be able to walk. Then usually there will be a nausea and vomiting. Okay. Nausea and vomiting is usually associated with the peripheral causes. But it varies. Okay, may or may not be in case of central cause. And hearing loss and tinnitus is more common. Common with peripheral variety, but it is rare in case of central vertebral. And hearing loss and tinnitus is common with peripheral, but associated neurological symptoms will be rare in case of peripheral, but it is more commonly seen with the central vertebral. So neurological neurological symptoms. Here it is rare, but it's common here. Okay, then what? Now we can write it here. And sixth feature is recovery. Okay, recovery is faster with peripheral. It recovery within days will happen, but it is very slow in case of central variety. Fast, but it will be slow in case of central cause. And head thrust sign. What is head thrust? I'll tell you later. So the head thrust sign is present in a peripheral vertebra, but it is absent in central. Present, absent. And these are the common distinguishing features between a peripheral and a central vertebra. So, the types of features of nystagmus, then imbalance, nausea, vomiting, hearing loss, tinnitus, neurological symptom, the head rest sign, and a faster recovery in case of peripheral vertebra. And also you have to know about the differences between a central vertebra. Okay, and